By sequencing the genomes of microbes that live in diverse environments, we can really learn a lot about inferring the evolutionary history of life on Earth, as well as many applications for bioprospecting, novel protein families, and biosynthetic gene clusters. We can reconstruct microbial metabolic networks and understand how these organisms are affecting Earth's biogeochemical cycles. But the vast majority of organisms on Earth cannot be cultivated and grown in the lab. And this is really prevented to date, or I would say this is really probably the greatest obstacle to obtaining genome sequences for these organisms. And this was illustrated really nicely in a paper published, I think in 2004, I might be wrong, but a little while ago by Dongying Wu and Jonathan Eisen and many, several current and former members of the JGI. And what they, one of the conclusions or one of the analyses they did in the paper was that they looked at the total phylogenetic diversity of organisms in this green genes database, which is simply a database of ribosomal RNA sequences derived from both environmental samples as well as cultivated isolates. You can see that the total phylogenetic diversity is denoted at the top of this curve here. And this darker curve in gray, dark gray, is the phylogenetic diversity of all organisms that have been isolated in pure culture. So again, you can see this big discrepancy highlighting the point. Recently, with advances in both DNA sequencing technologies and computational methods, we've actually been able to start reconstructing the genome sequences of microbes from metagenomic data, directly from the organism's natural environment, without the need for any cultivation or laboratory isolation. Really simply, the way this procedure works is you can perform DNA sequencing on an environmental sample, which generates millions of very short sequencing reads, which can then be assembled into longer sequences called contigs. And these contigs can then be grouped together into putative genomes or metagenome-assembled genomes, or MAGs for short. And I'll use this term throughout the talk. And so there's essentially computational methods that will do this prediction step based on shared features of these contigs, like their nucleotide composition and abundance in the sample. And without going into too many of the details, many of the co-authors and colleagues on this study constructed an automated pipeline to reconstruct these MAGs directly from the metagenomic data sets that we have in IMG. And applying this pipeline to, at the time, a little over 10,000 assembled metagenomes from IMG yielded over 52,000 of these metagenome assembled genomes, with and some of which were of extremely high quality. Looking at the environmental distribution of these genomes, they come from a variety of environments, including human and other host-associated environments, marine, freshwater, soil, the list goes on. And looking at the geographic distribution, we can see that these are just maps showing where these genomes came from. And you can see that they cover the majority of the world's oceans, as well as much of North America, Europe, and China. But I should say that this procedure, we weren't actually the first to do this kind of large scale analysis. So prior to this study, there had been a number of high profile publications that had done really large scale metagenomic assembly and binning, as well as a number of other studies that had done really large scale sequencing of isolates and single cell genomes. And so the question that we wanted to ask is, given all of the previous literature and large-scale efforts, how much novel diversity did we generate from our study? And so to do this, we compared the 52,000 genomes from our study together with over 500,000 genomes from previous studies. And these include, genomes from cultivated isolates, MAGs, and then also single cells. And what was pretty remarkable is what we found over 12,000 we found that our genomes represented over 12,000 species groups that were not found in any previously published study to date. Additionally, comparing the species level diversity of our study with previous studies, we found our study represented 18,000 species level groups, which was more than three times the number of any previously published study. And so what this really shows is that leveraging the really remarkable environmental diversity of the samples in IMG, we were able to uncover a tremendous amount of new microbial diversity. We additionally constructed a phylogenetic tree of all the genomes. So the ones from our study, plus the ones from previously published studies. In this tree, you can see that the genomes from our study in this outer ring broadly cover the full diversity of both archaea, shown here as a lineage on the left, and branching out across all of bacteria. Additionally, highlighted here in with these green branches and in this green colored strip is the new lineages that we discovered from our study. So overall, the genomes from our study added 44% to the phylogenetic diversity of bacteria and archaea. And the last thing that I just wanted to highlight is that looking at this blued color strip, you can see additionally that there remain very large lineages in the tree of life that have never been cultivated before in the lab. Okay, and so all of these data, all 52,000 genomes are freely available for the community to use in the IMGM system. Additionally, by collaborating through other groups, we were able to make available a number of other resources. Jose Faria constructed genome scale metabolic models that are available in KBase. Dan Uduare identified biosynthetic gene clusters, and Simon Rue identified integrated proviruses in these metagenome assembled genomes. And lastly, just looking to the future, I'm sure you've all heard of the data deluge. And so while the study that presented today went up to data from about fiscal year 2018, the growth of the data, future data, is really continuing to grow at a really rapid pace. And this is really going to provide new future opportunities to expand these kinds of studies to discover novel lineages across Earth's biomes. And with that, I'd just like to say thank you to the number of co-authors and contributors on this study, both from JGI and KBase, in particular to Emily, who, among other things, coordinated amongst a huge number of scientists who graciously provided their data to us and made possible such a large-scale study. And so I'd also like to say thank you to them.